Good evening, Saints, and I welcome you to our final presentation for the Sabbath. And we are going to be looking at the book of Luke chapter 5. But before we look into Luke chapter 5, there is something that I just want to respond to that has been coming up a lot from individuals who are watching and individuals who are live streaming, and it's the whole issue of offerings. So people have been asking, what do we do about offerings? And there I have very two clear positions. Number one, the state of the world as it is right now, I believe requires churches, pastors, and ministries to be very sympathetic. Quite a lot of people are going to be losing their jobs, and they need to save absolutely as much as they can in order to be able to finance their families going forward. This is the main and strongest reason why I don't call for offerings, because I believe now more than ever it is the duty of churches, it is the duty of pastors to be giving more than receiving. Especially as we look at the unemployment figures that are going to be rising all over the world. I do not believe for a second that offering is wrong. Offering is very biblical. However, it must be done with the right spirit, influenced by Jesus Christ and how he taught us and how Jesus cared about the poor and the needy. That is why if you have a belief that you are financially okay and you want to make an offering, approach that pastor privately, inbox on the live stream and make donations that you want to make. But as far as what churches should be going for, it is my strongest position right now that we should not be soliciting, and we certainly should not be coercing anyone into making any offerings at this point in time. I think the best advice that churches can give right now is for people to save and save as much as they can. We are going to have a bit of a difficult and a turbulent 2020 as world economies attempt to recover from this coronavirus, and therefore it is my truest belief that the God who owns the silver and gold will see all of us through. He will see the churches through. He will see the pastors, the bishops, the apostles, the prophets through. So like I am saying, only those who know and are aware that within the blessings God has given them, there is safety, there is security. Then you can reach out to your pastor, you can reach out to your church, you can reach out to the ministry, and you can say, here is what I have, how can I give it to you? But I would really strongly advise that churches and ministries and pastors should adopt a very sympathetic view currently because of what the world is going through. So I really hope that this answers the many people who have been asking questions about offerings, and it should be something that is easy for you to just cut out from this video and share. It's all about taking the position of Jesus Christ, who sympathized with the needy, who gave more than he received. That's very important that we go for. But also I want to share something here in the fact that the Bible definitely authorizes and calls upon believers to support gospel workers with offerings. But that's not the only means available. What the Bible also teaches us is that some of the apostles, like Peter, like Paul, they had their own skills and trades which they used to make income on the side. And then they focused on the ministry, and those who offered in the ministry were simply doing it out of a good heart. But the disciples were able to financially sustain themselves from their skills. And I think one of the things we will need to look into as pastors, as bishops and prophets going forward is for God to put in our hands skills that we can use to make an income so that we are not a financial liability to believers. So that when believers give, they must give because they truly are blessed and are inspired by the ministry God has put in our hands. And I certainly am in that frame of mind. I believe that when you send an inbox or a WhatsApp or whatever and you say, Pastor, can I have your bank account? It shouldn't be because I solicited. I shouldn't work your mind into it. It is when I do the work that God has asked me to do, that if that activates you to want to give, then you give. But the most important thing, particularly in this season, is for churches, ministries, ministers, pastors, prophets, apostles, all the fivefold ministries that are found in the organization of the church, to be more sympathetic with God's people as they are going through this tough time. I would even go as far as saying, and I know this is one of the things I'm about to say that will make me very unpopular with some people who are in leadership of churches, but I'm going to say it because I have biblical foundations through Jesus Christ for it. Now more than ever, churches should also be looking into their finances to see how they can donate in assisting to alleviate poverty, in assisting to make sure that those who will lose jobs can at least have some food on the table. I believe this is the season when churches need to be doing surveys of their local churches on the ground, asking who has lost their job because of COVID-19. And we should be channeling our offerings towards making sure that there will be some kind of food on the tables of those church members while the economy is trying to recover. Yes, we may not reach everyone and reach them the way they would have loved to be reached, but I think this is that time in history when churches, whether it be Adventist Church, Catholic Church, Methodist Church, Anglican Church, independent ministries, we have money in our coffers. Most of us are not taxed in the countries where we operate. Churches own properties worth millions. This is that time in the history of the existence of the Christian church when we should rise. A challenge has come up which calls upon the church to be the reflector of the character of Jesus Christ. So again, I am not by any means castigating any pastor or any ministry or church that will be receiving offerings. I'm simply saying, let that be motivated by the people blessed by our ministry, rather than us making videos and connecting blessings with money. I think that we are really abusing the word of God when we do that. What is needed right now is a church that reflects the character of Christ more than any other thing. So I hope I have put this one to rest. People who've been asking, how do we offer? I don't solicit offerings because I believe firmly that this is the season for us to save and prepare for whatever deliverance that God is preparing for us. Only those in any church and in any organization who feel financially secure that they still want to show their gratitude to gospel workers, yes, then those can approach unsolicited, uncoerced, unmanipulated, and give what they want to give as a response of what they have. But I'm also sending this message out to my colleagues who are pastors all over the world. I'm really saying it's possible that we may need to learn that the time has come for us to develop skills that will put bread on the table without us entirely necessarily needing churches to be the ones that put bread on our table. And you may ask, how do we do it? Well, the God we've been preaching about all of these years is now going to reveal to us how what we've been preaching to others will now need to be made practical for us. The jobs we've been praying for others to get, the skills, the education, the companies we've been praying for, as God has been answering us on behalf of our members, I think God can also answer us now on behalf of ourselves as well. Now, with that being said, let's get into the message for today. And the message for today we are finding in the book of Luke, chapter 5. And that is where we are going to be reading from verse 1 to 11. I'm going to say it again. Luke chapter 5, reading from verse 1 to 11. And as usual, we follow this format that on our morning service, we deal with something more theological. And then in the Vesper service, we deal with something that is more practical for day-to-day living. And let us look into this text and see how it can teach us some skills and better ways to live life in the coming week. The Bible says, "So it was as the multitude pressed about him to hear the word of God, that he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two boats standing by the lake. But the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put it a little out from the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, 'Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch.' But Simon answered and said to him, 'Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net.' And when he had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both these boats, so that they began to sink. When Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, 'Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord.' For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, 'Do not be afraid. From now on, I shall make you a catcher of men.' So when they had brought their boats to the land, they forsook all and followed him." The Lord always adds a blessing to the reading of his word. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, your Holy Spirit, we request that when the word has been read, we may understand its fullest meaning and its power may be unleashed in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Luke chapter 5. It begins, of course, as the chapter 4 ends. People, Israelites, who have been desperate, who have been suffering from different difficulties in their lives. Jesus has been born. He has now begun his ministry. When Jesus begins his ministry, he finds a nation in deep depression. Number one, they are colonized by the Romans. It is a painful state of racism, of xenophobia, and all forms of isms you could think about. The nation was under a great cloud of depression. Economically, people are not making as much as they should be making. The Romans are taxing them very hard. And so there is a systematic poverty that is pushed by the oppression of the Roman government. And of course, the Romans were like all the other colonizers. I remember watching a tweet from one of the opposition leaders in this country, a white lady. She tweets that apartheid, colonialism were not so bad because at least they left us with roads and bridges and infrastructure. That is what colonizers always think, that the dignity of your respect and freedom is worth the infrastructure they give you. That is how the Romans would oppress. They would build infrastructure and tax very heavily and say to the people, we have built you roads and bridges. Little did they understand that the cost of freedom and the cost of dignity and liberty is greater than a bridge and a highway. You cannot pay through a road for these things. And when Jesus arrives, there is that external oppression from the Romans. But internally, there is oppression from the church itself, the Judaic system, the Jewish synagogue, the priests, the Sanhedrin. They themselves were a heavy burden on the people. They were financially taxing to sustain. I love this situation because immediately it describes exactly where we are in our country today and many countries around the world. We have external oppressors. We have internal oppressors. We have governments that make life difficult and churches and spiritual bodies that also at the same time are just draining. And the Israelites were exactly in the same situation. Now, it was in that situation that Christ was born. And when Christ begins his ministry, he lands on this deeply burdened society. People are sick, people are poor, people are hungry, people are oppressed, people are going to church in the synagogues, and all they hear in the sermons is how sinful they are, how they are not going to make it to heaven, how they are far from God, and there is no hope in the sermons. Judaism was thriving on a strong legalism. The Pharisees and the Sadducees were mounting the pulpit every Sabbath, every prayer time, just to remind the people how far they are from the glory of God. And when the sermons ended, there was no easy way to come back to God. The list of things to do in order to come back to God was so high and so difficult, it was just not possible to be saved. And you need to think about that, because sometimes it becomes the state of church as well. You know, when you go to church, whether on Sabbath or Sunday or any other day, some of us have to endure sermons that are all about criticizing where we are failing. And yes, it's true we are failing, and we need to hear that. However, we cannot just hear that in the absence of hope in Jesus Christ. There has to be hope. There has to be grace. There has to be salvation in spite of our failures. When Jesus arrives, the messages, the sermons, they had no hope. There was no way out of the pit of sin. And when Jesus arrives, he addresses absolutely all these issues. His sermons brought life to people. People who had not gone to synagogues in years, they were going back because there was this Galilean whose messages were pulling them out of the deep muddy clay. Sinners had hope. They no longer had to drink their way to sleep just to cover their guilt and shame. Jesus would sit with the drunkards, and for the first time, the drunkards knew there's another way to solve this issue of life than drinking your way through it. As Jesus heals the sick, as Jesus raises the dead, it becomes clear to the people of Judah that finally someone has come also who offers you health, who offers you life, who puts bread on your table without taxing you, without being a burden to you. Now, when chapter 4 ends in the book of Luke, you find that the people were so desperate for Jesus that when Jesus tried to walk away, crowds in their hundreds, if not thousands, would stop him and say, "You cannot go. You've not solved my issue. You've not solved my issue." People had been waiting desperately for such a savior, and he had come. His words, his sermons healed them. His touch healed them. His prayer multiplied food. His words raised the dead. They finally were feeling relief. That is why when chapter 4 ends, the Bible says the people were blocking Jesus, saying, "You cannot leave Galilee just yet. You have to speak to us even more. You have to touch us more. You have to heal us more, because we have been waiting for such a time as this." And Jesus tries to say to them, "You are not the only people who need my assistance." In fact, he says in verse 43 of chapter 4, "I have to preach this gospel to many other cities. I must go because many others are in need of this salvation, are in need of this good news." Now the Bible says, realizing that the people had suffered too much, that the people were so desperate for him, he then saw two boats on the Lake Gennesaret. And when he saw the two boats, he climbed on one of the boats while the fishermen were washing their nets. The owner of one of these boats was Simon Peter, together with his brother Andrew. The other boat was owned by James and John, the sons of Zebedee. They were fishermen together in business. They were business partners. Now, then Jesus says to Peter, Peter who doesn't know him, Peter who's meeting him for the first time, Jesus says to him, "Could you push your boat a bit into the water?" Jesus is trying to create a gap between him and the people, because the people are just too many around him. And so from the boat, he taught again the words of life. When he was done, then Jesus said to Peter, "Throw your net in and then make a catch." Peter, an experienced fisherman, then says to him, "We've been doing this all day. We have gained nothing." And Peter then says, "However, because you say so, I will do it." Peter throws in the net. So much came out that his boat was about to sink. Calls James, calls John and the other boats around. They all bring into their boats so much that all of them, their boats almost sank. Let's look at practical lessons in this story that I'd like to share with you for us to try and implement in our life. First thing, Jesus now says to Peter, when he climbs onto the boat, he says to Peter, "Could I just borrow your boat, push it a bit into the water, allow me to use it?" Peter's boat represents your life, my life. Peter's boat represents your talents and my talents. Peter's boat represents your skills and my skills. Peter's boat represents our resources, the money in our bank accounts, and so on. We need to understand this. A time comes in all of our lives where Jesus climbs into your life and he asks you to borrow him your life as a boat, which he may use as a pulpit in order to change other people's lives. Now, the first thing you need to learn from Peter is this: whatever resources you have, be ready for Jesus to borrow your resources in order to change other people's lives. What boat do you have in your life? My boat could be this voice I use it to preach. Your boat could be a voice you use to sing. Your boat could be an account you use to buy food for the poor. And whatever we've got, we all have a boat that Jesus could stand on and change other people's lives out there. What is this I am talking about? Well, some people call it a purpose. Some people call it a calling. Some people have written books like A Purpose-Driven Life. For me, you don't need to even write big books about it. It's very simple. All of us have a purpose why we are in this world. And purpose is usually very simple to identify. If you were to ask me right now, how will I know when I've found my purpose? I will tell you simple things. Number one, your purpose or your calling is that one thing that you would be willing to do, even if no one ever said thank you, even if no one ever paid you, you would still be willing to do it. Number two, even if you get paid and thanked for it, it gives you more joy than the joy you receive when people say thank you or when people pay you. Number three, a purpose you will identify this way. It will transform people's lives more than it will benefit your own personal ideas of transformation. It will change people more than it will make you, what you know, feel good about yourself. Because a purpose looks outward rather than inwards. While it will bless you, while it will make you feel good, but certainly its outlook will be the others out there. Number four, your purpose or your calling will never discriminate by class, gender, race, or any other thing. A purpose seeks those who need it, regardless of how they look or they appear. And the last thing I want to share with you, a purpose allows you that the last thing you will hear every night when you go to sleep will be God saying to you, well done. And I can assure you, nothing is more blessed in a Christian life than the fact that before you fall asleep, you hear God say to you, well done, we will try again tomorrow. So that for me are the identifying markers. So let me be very clear, each and every one of us has a boat. Doesn't matter how old you are, everyone has a boat that Jesus can stand on in order to change other people's lives. Make your boat available. When Jesus comes and says, I need to stand on your bank account, I need to stand on your voice, I need to stand in your house, I need to stand in your job and transform other people's lives, stand up, push the boat into the water. Let God use your life and your resources as a pulpit for changing other people's lives. The second thing that happens in the story, Jesus teaches, preaches. When he is done, he says to Peter, take your net, throw into the water and make a catch. Firstly, let's talk about Jesus at an earthly level. Jesus is a carpenter, son of a carpenter, a trained carpenter. He is telling Peter, an experienced fisherman, how to do fishing. That's lesson number two. You see, if you want to grow in life, don't think the advice that will change your career will only come from people who studied the same career as you. A carpenter can transform the life of a fisherman. That is why you need to open up. There are many people out there who don't know the intricacies, the details of your job. Yet, by speaking a word or two, They can certainly give words that could transform your career. I know this as a pastor, that when I preach the word of God, people apply it in careers that I know nothing about. Yet when they apply it, it changes their lives. But the same is true also for me. When I read, I don't just read theological books. I read scientific books. I read business books. I read law books. Why do I do it? My ministry can benefit from the other pockets of wisdom that God has placed in other careers and faculties out there. Don't be arrogant. Pick up a book from law, even though you are not a lawyer. Pick up a business book while you are an engineer. Pick up an engineering article while you are a pastor. It will edify your life. Listen to other perspectives. Oh, not only fishermen can assist fishermen. Carpenters can also give advice to fishermen. Now, we live again. I love social media because I see a whole lot of pseudo-wisdom being shared there. I've watched celebrities on social media saying, when they are gloating, how can a person who doesn't even have the same house as me tell me how to do things in my career? My dear friends, that's arrogance. That right there is the reason why people fall. We can learn from anyone in this life. A billionaire can learn a lesson from their gardener who is just busy pruning roses out there. No one is too rich, too arrogant, too educated to be able to learn from other people. So open up. Open up. A doctor may be blessed by a conversation with a patient. Yes, it may happen. A lawyer may find life-changing lessons from a defendant that they were representing. Jesus the carpenter says to Peter the experienced fisherman, now throw in your net. What is happening here? Peter then says, I want you to separate Peter's statement into two. Part number one is about knowing my job. Part number two is about knowing what God can do. In part number one, Peter says, we have been fishing here all day and caught nothing. That is the arrogance of the experienced fisherman in him. That is the chartered accountant in you, the doctor in you, the pastor in you, the A student in you, the trader in you, the baker in you, the teacher in you, the nurse in you, the engineer in you, wanting to defend your profession. That is what happens to all of us. When someone who does not come from your field tries to offer you advice, we automatically become defensive. But then Peter was listening while Jesus was preaching. While Peter was there washing the net, he wasn't just washing. He was listening to this man who had borrowed his boat. And as Jesus was teaching, the power of the spoken word reminded Peter now that the man who tells you to throw the net, he may be a carpenter on earth, but it is clear that in heaven, he is the God who made the universe. So what did Peter do? He put his charism mentality aside and he began to think along, what can God do for me? Learn this about your career. Many of us will not even reach, you know, the ceiling of our careers, let alone the roof. Forget the sky. When they say the sky is the limit, that doesn't even include many of us. We are struggling just to reach the ceiling. Why? We are self-satisfied know-it-alls. I am a chartered accountant, I am a doctor, I am a pastor, I am a bishop. You can't tell me what to do. That is where we fall apart. Lose charism mentality. If you wanna grow, if you wanna be big, if you wanna reach for the stars, you better start paying attention even to the carpenter. When I fly, when I'm in malls, when I'm traveling to do a week of prayer and I'm in a hotel or a B&B somewhere, I listen to conversations. I listen to cleaners in a hotel cleaning our rooms. I listen when seated there eating breakfast to the couple or the family next to me. I don't listen for the joy of what is happening in their lives. I'm always looking for something that someone is going to say that is going to be inspirational. I listen, okay? And it's important. In my own home, I've been inspired by things that my wife and kids will say, not even knowing that this thing is inspiring me. They will mention it and move on, but I will find that phrase coming back and being planted in a particular verse, and suddenly I understand that verse based on a statement made by a child or a statement made by my wife. I just want you to open up and understand carpenters can make a difference even in the career of a fisherman. You've got to walk away from thinking that only you and those who sit in the same desk with you know what is going to happen. Some of us, where we work, our supervisors are heavily undereducated compared to us. Let me tell you, show respect to those people. They may have started this job at a time when apartheid did not give them the opportunity to study. As much as they don't have a degree, as much as they don't have a master's degree, what they have is industry knowledge that is highly valuable. Listen, even a carpenter can help change the catch of the day for a fisherman. So, as I have said, Peter separates the two. He first reacts through charism defensiveness, but then he realizes the man he heard preaching was somebody who clearly is not from this world. Then he moved to saying, what can God do for me? And that's our third lesson that I want us to look at today. Learn to look at what God can do rather than what your own achievements can do for you. Achievements have limitations. God does not. I want to share a quick illustration of something that happened to me. Some years ago, I met a gentleman who is a mayor and who was also a member of our church. Then I was still in college, I was studying. There was going to be a conference for local government municipalities, SALGA and all that. And this gentleman asked me to come and make some presentations, motivational ones, as well as a scriptural ones. So I flew from Cape Town, where I was studying. I came to where the conference was going to be. When I landed at the airport, there was a gentleman there to pick me up, driving a very nice German sedan. And took me to the BNB where I would be kept. The day came when we had to start the events. On our way to the venue, as we approached the venue, we realized that vehicles, because of security, were entering through certain credentials. Drivers would show certain credentials and then they would enter the gate. This driver says to me, "Where are your credentials to enter?" I had not been given any credentials yet. The mayor who had invited me, we had not met yet. And I said to him, "I have no credentials." And as we approached the gate, I was awaiting embarrassment. Then suddenly, from a black Mercedes, this mayor comes out, goes to the security guards, looks at the car I am in, and he sees me. He points at the car I am in. He instructs that it comes forward. My driver shifts and comes forward. And we entered. How did I enter? I had no credentials, but I knew a man on the inside. This is what believing in God is about. We have a man in the inside, and his name is Jesus. When you don't have the necessary connections, the credentials for success in this world, speak to the man inside the kingdom. His name is Jesus. He will identify you in a queue, and he will come through for you. After these 35, 40 days of the lockdown in South Africa and lockdowns in many other countries, many of us will be jobless. But I want to give you courage. We may have hit a time where the skills you have will not be able to cross over with you to the other side of the Red Sea of this coronavirus. I have looked online and I have seen universities offering online courses for free during these lockdowns. This is the time to stop being careerism defensive and ask God, "What can you do for me?" You have a man on the inside whose name is Jesus. Should you find that when we cross over, you will no longer have the necessary connections, skills to be able to succeed, call the man on the inside. He will identify you in a queue and he will give you power for a new life, a life that even you perhaps may not even know how it will be, but that's okay. This is why we speak about things that God can do, not I can do. Because God can do things that are beyond my ability to plan or even to anticipate. Peter understood that now his career had to pause and God had to work. So Peter says, "You know what, Lord? Even so, I will obey you. Because I have heard the power of your teachings, I will obey you." They threw their net. That's the next lesson. God never throws a net for anyone. You must throw the net. Let me be very clear. You are not going to prophesy your way to success. Stop allowing bishops to fool you and tell you, "Shout, I receive." You will shout till Jesus comes and you will receive nothing. Faith requires you to then walk towards what you believe. The story of Jesus at the wedding in Cana, when Jesus instructed those servants to take the jars of water to the MC, they did not wait with the jars until the water became wine.
They picked up jars with water. They put them on their shoulders with water. What did they do? They began to walk to the MC. They did not know whether when they get to the MC, they will be embarrassed or what. All they knew is that he had instructed them to go to the MC. Where is the miracle? As they walked to the MC, it is then that the water became wine. You've got to learn. It is not enough to believe. It is not enough to shout, I receive. Don't let them fool you. You cannot prophesy your way to success. After the prophecy, throw the net. Walk towards the MC. Fold your sleeves and get down to the business of changing your life. Now, when they pulled, what did they discover? More fish than they could ever get through their own skills. Can I just be allowed to come back to that text again that I love? Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more. In all their years as fishermen, never had they pulled so much fish. The fish of their skills and the fish of his ability were different. You will continue to think you are successful while relying on your skills when you don't know there's a whole world out there of what is immeasurably more than you could have through Jesus. But because you think things must be done by your understanding, you will be fooled by mediocrity and you will convert it into success. With God, you could achieve way more than we could ever think or imagine. When they pulled out, it was too much. It was so much that they needed to call other boats. When God blesses you, he not only thinks about you, he also thinks about those that surround you. Be a blessing to others. I don't know how we lost this. When you read the Old Testament in the book of Leviticus and the book of Numbers, God says, when you farm, do not harvest everything. Leave a corner for the poor, so that the poor may come and they may harvest from what you have left. It has always, always been the teaching of heaven that whatever you are blessed with, also make sure that you leave a portion for the poor. In our salaries, we should be leaving a portion for the poor. Some of us are suffering because we keep eating the portion of the poor. And because we are selfish and greedy, God has not decided not to open other doors for us. Don't eat the portion of the poor. Leave it. When you pull fish, call other boats. When you earn a salary, pass a corner for the poor. When you go to do groceries for your family, also fill a plastic bag for somebody else who can't afford. See to it that in your boat of blessings, the one Jesus is standing on, when Jesus now blesses you for giving him your boat, when you begin to reap the benefits of giving Jesus your boat, prepare to bless others as well. We must be a blessing to others. As pastors, for example, we live by the word. However, As much as there are many churches and individuals who can financially compensate us to say thank you for ministering to me, we must also be willing to go to those churches who can't afford to pay us. There is a blessing even there in allocating a portion of your ministry to those who can't afford to say thank you, men of God. Those who will only say thank you with their tears. As pastors, we must also go there. It is not right that we only visit the homes of the rich. We pray only for the rich. We preach in churches of the rich. We must make ourselves available even on the portion of poverty in the garden of God, so that there too there may be a blessing that will transform. You may be a doctor and you have a surgery and your surgery is doing well. Take time to go to the poor who will never be able to afford your services. Also, be their clinician. Assist them. Let that be your portion. So all of us, in whatever you are doing, in whatever business you are in, you can still leave a portion for others. As you are pulling in your fish, remember others as well. Then in the end, the story says, Peter cried and said, "Oh Lord, get away from me, for I am a sinner." Peter had reached his point of conversion. Please notice this for me, that is very important. Peter's conversion is not what we expect. We usually expect God to save you and then use you. But notice here, God first used Peter and his boat and then converted him. What am I saying to you, friends? And this is going to be very interesting for you to understand. There are people who don't have a relationship with God yet. People we invite to our churches, our best friends, our relatives, who just go to church because we invited them. But let me tell you, you know that person, when they arrive in church, just to be given an opportunity to share their thoughts on what maybe we were studying as a group, the joy of feeling God speak through them may be the reason why they convert. In some cases, God may use you even before you convert, and the joy of being used by Him may lead you to your conversion. Peter converts, and then God says to him, "Now you will become a fisher of men." Peter never stopped fishing for fish. All his life, he kept fishing. When Jesus had left this world, Peter used fishing to still put money in his pocket. What are we learning here? When Jesus said, "Now I will make you a fisher of men," Jesus was not suggesting that Peter must now lose his skills for life. What Jesus was simply saying is, now everything you do for the glory of my kingdom. So, I am saying to you, in application, believing in God is not an excuse not to do your part. Just because you are a believer doesn't mean you will suddenly pass exams by saying, "Jesus will see me through." You can be a believer, a fisher of men, but still have your skills for fishing. In other words, wake up every day and do your part. I want to close this message with a story that my principal told when I was in high school. He says, there was a young boy who was a faithful deacon in church. He loved serving in God's church. Day in and day out, before the young man went to school, he would go into the mission and ask if there is anything he can do. The priest would give him duties to do, and the priest would quickly say to him, "Now go to school and allow God to teach you other things." The boy would go to school. When the boy comes back from school, he would be so excited to go back to the mission. And when he is done helping at the mission, the priest again would say to him, "Now go home and sit and study so that the school may teach you other things." But when the boy got home, he would lie on his bed, rejoicing in the joy of serving in the mission, and would not study. When the exam time came, the young man took all of his books, went to the priest. He laid them at the feet of the priest and said, "Father, please bless my books. Exam season is about to start." And the priest blessed the young man, prayed for him as exam season was about to start, and blessed his books. Little did the priest know, the young man collected his books, went home. He put all his books under his mattress. He slept and prayed that all this wisdom in the books should now enter his mind, because he had been a faithful servant of God. The young man failed. Dear friends, faith without works is dead. If you believe God is the God of success, let your faith lead you to working hard. Don't shout, "I receive," and stop there. Shout, "I receive," as an affirmation of faith. Then go and do your work. May the Lord bless you. Borrow Jesus your boat. Allow him to use your life to change other people's lives. That may be your calling or your purpose. Allow Jesus to teach you through other people. Carpenters can also teach fishermen how to do things. And remember, don't let careerism stop you from learning from other people. Be aware, when your career is no longer able to sustain you, there is a man inside the kingdom. His name is Jesus. When the credentials of this world fail you, call Jesus. He is the divine inside connection who will see us through. And when you have been given the instruction, don't just believe, throw the net. Don't just believe, take the jar of water, walk towards the MC. It is there that your water will turn into wine. It is there that your net will catch fish. Faith is not just shouting. It's also walking in accordance to the words we believe. And when all is said and done, be a doer of God's word, so that all glory and honor may go to God. May God bless you. May God keep you. May he prosper you. May he lead you and I to learning whatever skills are necessary that will allow us to not only prosper in this world, but also may we have the faith that will carry us to see Jesus at his second coming. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless us in this world, but also for the world to come. Bless us with the skills and the spirit of hard work. Bless us with the faith and the acceptance of your grace. And I pray that when we have done it all in this world, may we know that ultimately all that we have done will not take us to heaven. Only the inside man, Jesus Christ, will take us into those pearly gates. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine,
To him who is able to present us faultless and blameless before the throne of grace. To the only true God, invisible and incorruptible, be honor and glory as we continue to live by the power of your word. In Jesus we have prayed. Amen.